Hello, I'm Amber Lovett.
And I'm Mayank Khanna. We are part of Michigan Makers, an after-school makerspace program run by the University of Michigan School of Information. We are here to talk about how to budget for sustainable makerspaces. Today, we are going to talk about how to budget for the future of your makerspace. We are also going to cover how should we go about selecting cost-effective tools and what should we really do when the budget for our makerspace is running really low.
So let's start by talking about budgeting for the future of your makerspace. As we talk about budgeting for the future, let's begin by thinking of a specific case study. 3D printers are a very popular tool in a lot of makerspaces, and one that I think we can all agree can be a really awesome tool. So let's say that you buy a 3D printer for $1,000. Next, you need to buy some filament for your printer. And let's say you need to buy some additional filament in different colors or different kinds of filament, or you just ran out. Now, what happens when your 3D printer breaks, especially if this is one of the main tools in your makerspace? Well, you have to fix it, and perhaps you spend some of your own time fixing that, which has a cost associated with it, or perhaps you pay someone else to take a look. And it turns out that you need an additional part to replace one that's broken on your 3D printer. So as you can see, the cost that you initially paid is going to steadily increase as you account for repair and consumables. So by consumables, we mean the supplies that you're going to have to replace at some point. In the case of a 3D printer, it might be the filament, but it could be a lot of other things that are going to be used up in your makerspace on a regular basis. And obviously, there's going to be repair costs, especially when it comes to some of your bigger ticket equipment that can be often very difficult and complicated to repair, and also has a lot of cost to repair to it, particularly when you need to order replacement parts. Of course, when we talk about budgeting, there will be other expenses besides just your equipment, repair, and consumables. This chart is from the New York Hall of Science Blueprint for Maker Programs for Youth, and this is going to be one of the resources linked under Lesson 5. So here you can see they've broken up the costs for your makerspace into direct costs, indirect costs, and capital expenditures. Capital expenditures is what you probably think most about when you are planning your makerspace. That's the equipment you're going to buy for the makerspace, but direct costs would be the costs for consumables, storage, other supplies, also costs for labor that are going to come as a part of running your makerspace. And then indirect costs are going to be sort of the hidden operating costs for your makerspace in terms of renting space if that's needed, the utilities that are going to perhaps be increased through the use of your new equipment, any kinds of permits that you need to have the equipment that you're purchasing in your makerspace, as well as those repair and maintenance costs for the equipment. So now we're going to look at a sample budget. This sample budget is from Make Magazine's High School Makerspace Tools and Materials publication, and this is also going to be one of the resources linked under Lesson 5, so you can take a closer look at this and some of the other sample budgets on the resources section there. So you can see here they have broken up their sample budget into categories by the general module or type of tool or activity, for example, general or woodworking, electronics, etc. And they have then broken up within each category into tools and materials, tools being the capital equipment expenditures, and materials being the consumables, storage, and other costs. So those would be your direct costs associated with that equipment. And in your budget, you might have to break down tools a little bit further into talking exactly about what specific tools you'll be purchasing. And then they also have on here a column for upkeep, which is their projected maintenance and repair costs for the equipment. So as you can see, it's important to include all of these categories in here. One thing that they don't have on this sample budget is the expected costs for any kinds of utilities or staffing, and that is one thing that you might want to consider in the cost for your budget, anticipating that there will be some other costs in addition to just your equipment, materials, consumables, and maintenance.
And now we are going to talk about how to select cost-effective tools for your makerspace. The first thing to consider when selecting tools for your makerspace is diversity. one needs to ensure that there is a correct balance between modern and traditional technologies. This will allow your kids to experiment with different kinds of making and hence open more opportunities for them. While we need to think about the diversity of tools, we also need to think about their versatility. Imagine your makerspace is recently approved of a $50 budget. Would you choose to spend those $50 on a tool like Drawdio, which makes sounds using hand drawings, or spend that money on a box of Lego kits that exposes children to endless creativity? We also need to think that whether these tools are applicable to a broad range of audience. These could be several grades in your school, or it could be the different age groups in your makerspace. Another thing to consider is scalability. We need to ensure that these tools not only work for a single person, but work for a group of people as well. We also need to determine whether these tools allow students to build skills over time, moving from simple to complex projects. Another way to ensure that you have cost-effective tools is to have a cost per project. If you have multiple kids in your school makerspace or your maker program, buying a larger tool would still have a lower cost per project. This will ensure that you're making the most out of your budget for your school makerspace program.
So now we'd like to talk about what to do when your budget runs low. As educators, we know that we often have to work with a very tight budget. And unfortunately, not all projects are selected to be funded. But at Mission Kid Makers, we have always tried to do our best to work with a tight budget. One of the most obvious ways to work on a low or no budget is to accept donations. Now, you may be used to already accepting donations for materials. Some of the kinds of materials that we accept donations for can be as diverse as old Christmas ornaments or Easter eggs, donations of fabric that can be reworked, or old clothes which can be refashioned. We also accept donations of old electronics, which can be used for appliance autopsies. Basically, anything that someone might be giving away, whether that's a local crafter or a parent in your school, can be accepted as a donation and used as a raw material for one of your makers in your school. You can also accept donations in terms of time. The more hands you have in your space, the better. Maybe you have parents in your community who are willing to volunteer, or perhaps students who are very passionate about making and want to help out in the space. Having more people in your space means that you have more time to devote to your tasks, and it also helps you free up time for management and your teaching and other things that are demanding on your time. Think about, as you're recruiting volunteers, finding people not just involved within your school, but also within the larger community who might be willing to donate some of their time to help make your makerspace a success. You may also be able to recruit volunteers who are experts in a particular field or skill. Recruiting these kinds of volunteers, perhaps from local makers or other labor unions, college students, people who have a particular set of skills that could be valuable to your makerspace, can help you to increase the set of offerings that you make available to your students, and it can add a lot of richness and diversity, not just in terms of tools, but in terms then of providing access to experts who can teach things that you may not be equipped to teach personally. The final thing we want to talk about with budgeting is low or no cost projects. Regardless of how big your budget is, it's always a great option to have affordable projects so that you can ensure the long-term viability of your makerspace. Projects that use a base of affordable materials like paper, cheap LEDs or batteries, or donations of what we fondly refer to as junk can be remade into really innovative projects with some creativity. And doing these kinds of affordable projects is a really great way to make sure that your budget stretches as far as it can and to also allow your makerspace to remain viable when that budget runs out. Thank you and good luck as you create your budget for your future makerspace.